Good morning.
Good morning.
So good to see you all. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Great to have you here in our sacred space, making our space sacred by your presence. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Buffalo. I want to especially welcome all the newcomers who are here and all the folks who have been coming a few times. It is great to have you with us this morning on this lovely summer day. My name is Joan Montagnus, and I have the honor and privilege of serving you, this congregation, whoever you are, even if this is your first time crossing our threshold. At the moment, I serve you because you're part of our congregation. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Buffalo. We are blessed to be together, and we acknowledge that the land upon which we meet rests upon the traditional territories of the Haudenosaunee people, traditional nations of this land. And they continue to struggle for justice and self-determination. Little note on that, because sometimes I say that and it just glosses over us. I've recently found out the Unitarians were involved with the residential schools. They not only ran them, but advocated for them. I'm hoping to do some research on that and present it to you a little bit later on. In this church, we encourage you to get your COVID vaccines and boosters. It's all good. I'm happy to say that in our congregation at the moment, masks are optional attire. And we invite you to be comfortable, and we invite you to care for yourselves and each other, however you see that to be. The theme-based bulletin board is back. If you have a look in the parish hall, and there's coffee and treats apparently in the parish hall today after the service, you'll see a bulletin board. Our theme this month is cultivating growth. I should know this. This month, our artist is Sonara Marquis, and you're invited to share what's growing within you by sharing your thoughts on the bulletin board. There are colorful paper butterflies, flowers, and leaves that you can post up there. You can write with magic markers that are there, and there are thumbtacks with which to post your messages onto the bulletin board. So have fun with that. Share your thoughts and reflections and what is growing within you. And now from the music department, our casual concert series continues next Saturday at 2 p.m. right here, I think, in this sanctuary. If not, it'll be on the front lawn, but it'll be somewhere on campus. Singer-songwriters and multi-instrumentalists Derek Evans and Nick Randall will perform an original 1 hour and 18 minute song cycle for two voices, electric guitar and electric bass. This new work, entitled Daryl Donahue One Day, paints a musical portrait of a fictionalized white-collared stranger, with each song dedicated to an hour of that day. I think that sounds fascinating. And now a message from Rachel Clark. There will be a gathering of youngish adults after the service on July 24th. So that's what, 2 weeks from now, something like that? Approximately 11:30, so after the service. Meet at the garden entrance of the parish hall, and then they're gonna head off to Spot Coffee on Elmwood for brunch. The Youngish Adults group hopes to gather on a regular basis in the future, so she invites you to join them. If you have questions, talk to Rachel Clark. Rachel, are you in the... There she is! All right, you can make yourself known a little bit more. That is Rachel. Go and speak to her if you are a youngish adult and interested in gathering with others. And today I am delighted to introduce you to our guest preacher, the Reverend Margaret Weis. Reverend Margaret is a lifelong Unitarian Universalist, originally from the Boston area. She has served as parish minister in Rhode Island and in upstate New York, and as a hospital chaplain in Connecticut. Most recently, she and her wife moved into their camper. Just let that settle for a minute. And traveled around the country for roughly 9 months. She is a lover of travel, apparently, vegetarian and vegan cuisine, bicycling, hiking, and best of all, napping. Reverend Margaret and her wife live in Ithaca with their rescue dog, Bader Ruth. That is all the announcing I have for you. Last week, my father said, "My goodness, there were no announcements, Joan. Hope you're happy now, Dad." Today, as we join our hearts and minds, as we call ourselves into worship, as we clear ourselves of distractions, clearing ourselves from the mosquito whining and the nutshells, the sediment and detritus of our busy, busy and fairly disturbing times. Today, as we focus our hearts and minds, we seek clarity and understanding. The Buddha once asked a student, "How long is a human life?" The student replied, "Life is so brief that it seems but a day." The Buddha then asked a second student the same question, "What is the true length of a person's life?" And the second student thought for a while and then responded, "Life is the time taken to eat a single meal." And so the Buddha asked a third student, "How long is life?" And the third student replied, "The time in a single breath." "Exactly so," said the Buddha. "You understand. Come, let us take a collective breath. And prepare ourselves for worship. Let's join in lighting our chalice with our chalice lighting affirmation as printed in your order of service. We gather in loving community, inspiring one another to transform ourselves to create a more just and compassionate world. And now let's join in singing. Come sing a song with me, number 346 in your gray hymnal.
Sing a song with me that I might know your
want to invite you now into a time of guided imagery. And this is completely invitational. It is completely optional. If you feel like participating, I think I'm on. Aren't I on? Yes. Okay, good. If you feel like participating, please participate at your leisure. If you feel like dropping out at any time, feel like do that. If you want to keep your eyes open, keep your eyes open. If you want to close your eyes, close your eyes as we go through the imagery together. If you're uninterested at all in any of this, do Sudoku, do some reading, do your knitting, whatever you want to do, figure out dinner, but please keep the quiet so your neighbor can settle into the silence. And so, make ourselves comfortable. You might want to begin our meditation just with setting your feet flat on the floor, or you can lie down on the floor with your hands maybe resting on your lap and your posture in a comfortable upright position. The tension you hold on your shoulders just draining down onto the ground, out the door, and take a few cleansing breaths in and out, in and out. In and out. Now imagine you're walking along a beach. It's a beautiful, long, white beach. And you're all by yourself. And it's very safe and very comfortable. Feels wonderful to have the sand in your toes. It's warm, lovely, and soft. And the sea breeze gently blowing your face. And the ocean's waves coming in and out. You can hear them crashing onto the beach. And you can hear the seagulls in the air. The salt in the air. You've been looking for a place to be quiet and safe and comfortable for a long time. And this beach is all yours. You look out onto the ocean and you see the surface waters are dappled in sunlight and green colors. And below them, the purple under the waves. And then into the depths, you see that the water is a deep gray. All the colors clash and move around together, and the waves come up and froth and crash on the ocean beach. And you can feel the power of the earth breathing. Oh, shun. Oh, shun. Oh, shun. You continue to walk along the beach and see ahead of you a white and blue beach house. It's beautiful. Or maybe it's a temple or some sort of castle. There's a path leading into the beach house, and it's very inviting and welcoming. And so you walk along the path into the beach house. And the doors open, and you feel very safe and comfortable. As you cross the threshold, it's cool inside after the sun on the beach, and you're in a large hall filled with plants and paintings. There's a stairwell, big marble stairwell, leading up to the second floor, and you want to climb that stairway. But you notice there's a very heavy backpack on your back. And you realize you've been carrying this for a long time. And it's just too heavy to carry upstairs. The backpack is full of your troubles and worries, your concerns and grudges. And you make a choice to take the backpack off. Just set it down on the floor. And as soon as you let it go, all of those worries, all of those concerns, all of those grudges, all of your troubles, you feel lighter, released, free. And so you begin to climb the staircase. And with every step up, you feel more clarity, more contentment, more joy, more happiness. When you get to the top of the stairs, you feel strong and confident. And as you explore, you see a big comfy chair in front of a window. So you sit down in that chair, make yourself comfortable, and look out the window over the powerful ocean in front of you. And you hear the waves calling, "Oh, Sean. Oh, Sean. Oh, Sean." And you know you are at home. And now I invite you to recall yourself back into this space, into this sanctuary, the weight of your body, the sounds around you, and the weight of your body coming down, your hands, your feet on the floor, and gently open your eyes. A deep breath in, and let it go. Part of what we do every week is we take an offering, And when we take this offering, and especially because every week we share that offering with a social justice cause outside our church walls, every week what we're doing is reminding ourselves and ourselves as a corporate entity, as a congregation, as a group of people, that we belong to something larger than ourselves. We tune back into that reality and we make it tangible. This month, we are supporting the good work of Jericho Road's Vive Shelter. Vive has a 30-year legacy of providing safe refuge and assisting those who wish to make a refugee claim in Canada or who are seeking asylum protection in the United States. And they do this by providing safety, shelter, food, and legal help. To support our Share the Ministry plate, you can use the PayPal button by going to our website, www.buffalouu.org, and clicking on the blue donate button. You can go old school and send us a check at the UU Church of Buffalo, 695 Elmwood Avenue, Buffalo, New York, 14222. Or you can arrange an automatic deposit with your bank. Imagine that. If yours is a gift to the Share the Plate ministry, please write SHARE on the memo line, and it will be shared between Vive and the church operating budget. If yours is a welcome gift to our congregation, please write PLEDGE 2022 on the memo line. Either way, please write UUCB on the important line. Thank you so much for cultivating generosity and growth in our community and in ourselves. Thank you.
Good morning. It's so good to be here. This is my first time in this sanctuary, and it is so beautiful. And I am just so grateful for the gift to be able to lead worship with my colleague, Joan. You all are so lucky to have her as your minister. It's rare that we get to make worship happen together. And so I know this is because there wasn't a worship. Anyway, the logistics of church, but I'm grateful to be able to share this space with Joan and with all of you. And thank you for your warm welcome here to Buffalo. As Joan mentioned, my wife and I have spent some time traveling around, and we visited something like 21 or 22 states. And ultimately, we decided to come back to upstate New York, to return to Ithaca, because as beautiful and as wondrous, as amazing as this country is, there's something about upstate New York for like those 2.5 months that we're in right now. That's fabulous. So thank you for your warm welcome. The reading I'd like to share with you this morning is written by my colleague and friend, Reverend Angela Herrera. It's called A Prayer for Travelers. This is a prayer for all the travelers, for the ones who start out in beauty, who fall from grace, who step gingerly looking for the way back, and for those who are born into the margins, who travel from one liminal space to another, crossing boundaries in search of center. This is a prayer for the ones whose births are a passing from darkness to darkness, who all their lives are drawn toward the light and keep moving, and for those whose journeys are a winding road that begins and ends in the same place, though only when the journey is completed do they finally know where they are. For all the travelers, young and old, aching and joyful, weary and full of life, the ones who are here, the ones who are not here, the ones who are like you, and they're all like you, and the ones who are different, for in some ways we each travel alone. This is a prayer for traveling mercies and sure-footedness and clear vision, for bread, for your body and spirit, for water, for your safe arrival, and for everyone you meet along the way. I want to invite you to join with me in a few moments of prayer and reflection. Once again, we find ourselves waking to another beautiful day, and still the news of natural disasters, international conflict, terror in our schools and our streets, and daily struggles abound. Sometimes it is all too much. For some time, those of us who have followed Mr. Rogers' advice to look for the helpers, we do. We look for them. We find them. Sometimes we are them. And the helpers are tired and burned out and in need of care themselves. In those moments when we find ourselves yearning for a sense of hope, in those moments when we struggle to see a way forward, may we be reminded of our resilience and our courage and our community. Together, may we lift up those in our lives who are in need of encouragement and care and celebration. Let us call their names into this shared holy space now. May this cloud of witnesses join us as we remember how to build resilience in ourselves. A few years ago, I wrote this recipe down, and I'd like to share it with you. It's been tweaked over time. It's needs to be adjusted as necessary. It sometimes yields more servings than anticipated. Sometimes it needs a bit more of this ingredient or that. And it comes from generations before me. And I've added my own flavor along the way. A recipe for resilience. One part courage. Two parts tears of failure and doubt. One part deep listening. One part each of both silence and laughter. A dash of trust, a pinch of wonder, a heaping scoop of naps and snacks. In a separate bowl, mix together family, friends, those who challenge you to be your best self, those with whom you disagree. Add slowly to the larger pot. Add a bay leaf for, I don't know, whatever it is bay leaves do. Does anyone know? Let it simmer for as long as you need, which is often longer than you realize or anticipate. Keep the heat at an even temperature, hot enough to cook throughout, but not so hot that it burns the bottom. Can be served room temperature, warm, even cold if necessary. Serve alongside your favorite soft blanket or dog or cat or other soft item. Make often. Share with others. Hold on to the leftovers. You'll need them after a long day that challenges your soul. A recipe for resilience. May it be so. The American author and writer Starhawk once wrote, "We are all longing to go home to some place we have never been, a place half remembered and half envisioned we can only catch glimpses of from time to time, community. Somewhere there are people to whom we can speak with passion without having the words catch in our throats. Somewhere a circle of hands will open to receive us. Eyes will light up as we enter. Voices will celebrate with us whenever we come into our own power. Community means strength," Starhawk writes, "that joins our strength to do the work that needs to be done, arms to hold us when we falter, a circle of healing, of friends, somewhere where we can be free." In this piece, Starhawk speaks about what it feels like when we come into our own power. And I think that for some of us, that's when we're in community with other people. And for some of us, it's when we feel connected to that still, small voice within ourselves. For others of us, it might be the way we feel when we remember how small we are amidst the magnificence of this natural world. For many of us, that sense of community, those of us who are Unitarian Universalists, it might come from that space when we're in a place of religious freedom. Perhaps it was the feeling you had when you first were welcomed into a UU congregation, maybe today, maybe here. Or maybe the way you felt when you were told that you are loved for who you are, not despite it. This is the sense that we are held and powerful all at once, that we are indeed free. And it may be simultaneously exciting and terrifying. Maybe this is why we still come together in community and have for generations. even in the new ways that we come together in this new world, in our new normal since COVID-19. The ways we gather might look and feel different, and they are different in some ways. But in some ways, they're the same as they've always been. That unity that we feel, a commitment we have to be in community with other people who are wondering about the same big questions that we are wondering about. There's a unity and a commitment that comes from knowing that our struggles aren't all that different, that we travel together, that we are free together. In our reading this morning, my colleague Angela Herrera explores the ways of the traveler, the way we step gingerly, sometimes move fast, other times move with such care and intention. And she acknowledges that sometimes life is a winding road that begins and ends at the same place. She reminds us that all of us, each of us, is separate and united, an individual and a part of a greater community made up of all humankind. We're all on a journey, whether we are going someplace or we're staying home. Sometimes that journey is just in our own mind and heart. Some of it is bound up in our relationships with others and ultimately with ourselves. And some of it happens when we move outside our comfort zone into that place that makes our palms sweat and our heart beat faster. Some of that journey we've chosen. Other pieces have been chosen for us by circumstances or experiences we didn't want and didn't ask for. And in that moment, carrying all of that, we find ourselves with a choice of which path to choose, whether or not to listen to that still small voice, the angel and devil on our shoulders, that moment of the pros and cons list, the moment of choice, of wondering, of commitment. What guides us? What is it that helps you find your way forward? Do you keep moving forward simply because you're being propelled in that direction? Sometimes. Do you keep moving forward because it's easier than stopping? Sometimes. Do you stop because it's too hard to get started? Sometimes. Keep moving forward because you're committed to a destination, strengthened by your progress. What is it that propels you forward in that moment? What is it that helps you to pivot when you need to? And who or what are the touchstones on your journey, the breadcrumbs you leave to find your way back, the pieces you need to bring with you? How do you decide what comes next? This brings me back to community. Our Unitarian Universalist Association president, the Reverend Susan Frederick Gray, says this: "We sometimes wrongly say it is the absence of creed that is most important to who we are as Unitarian Universalists. This is wrong," she says. "Any one of us could practice religious freedom at home on Sunday mornings. Some of us are. We could practice religious freedom all day long, every day, and never come into community. But it is covenant that brings us out of isolation. Covenant within these walls, covenant with those who are joining as best they can. Covenant that brings us out of selfish concerns, out of individualism, to join ourselves to something greater, to become a part of a community that is working to practice love, to dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge and wisdom together, to find better ways to live our lives and live in the world." Becoming part of a community is practicing how to love. We said that in our chalice lighting words this morning. This is what we're doing here. We're practicing. We're asking these questions of ourselves and of each other, of our elders and our children and all of us in between, day in and day out, striving to live our values, making the right choices, leading authentic lives of integrity. We're practicing living into the answers to our big questions together. Now, I used to think that the only way to be a person of purpose and deep sincerity of faith was to be silent and still and alone. I therefore did not see myself as one of those people because I am very rarely silent or still or alone. But you know what I mean. Silent retreats, meditation, pilgrimages. Thoreau, alone in his cabin at Walden Pond, with only the silence and the birds and the rippling waters to join him in his deepest thoughts. But you know what? Thoreau had friends, too. Emerson used to come visit him. In fact, the cabin at Walden Pond was on his family's land, and I recently learned that his mother would often come to visit him, mostly bringing sandwiches and, yeah, to do his laundry. Truth, whole other sermon in and of itself. But here's what I'm going to take from that. Even in those moments when we need to stop, to be silent, to reconnect with that small, still voice, we still need other people. If we've learned anything in these years of the pandemic, it is that we need one another and that we need to be creative in the ways that we join together. And so, in order to be pious or faithful or spiritual or deep, we don't have to denounce everything and everyone. We don't necessarily have to be silent and still. I'm thinking about that book by Elizabeth Gilbert, Eat, Pray, Love. How many have read that book? There was a movie too. I like the book better. In it, she reflects on being a pious and dedicated person. She's at this ashram, and she decides that she is going to take a vow of silence and be a person who is introspective and quiet and pious. She believes that this is what is necessary to be a faithful person, to be quiet, to be still. And then she is assigned the role in her ashram of head hostess. This role requires her to be outgoing and cheerful, speaking with lots of people all day, welcoming them. And as an inherently boisterous and extroverted person, it comes naturally to her, but she's unsure because she's wanted to be this religious, pious person. And then she's reminded of this saying, God dwells in you as you. God dwells in you as a powerful statement. Let's replace the word God with love. Love dwells in you as you. In other words, there's only one you. You are unique and wonderful and beautiful just as you are. You are one of the beautiful ways that love manifests in this world, and you have your own unique way of bringing that love into a world that needs you. And if that means showing up in loud, boisterous, joyful ways, then that's an act of faith too. As Howard Thurman once said, ask what makes you come alive and go do it, because what the world needs is people who have come alive. Perhaps tuning into this truth again and again is the only task of our lives. Tuning in requires silence and stillness, and sometimes requires us to move forward into community. So how do we decide? How do we know when and how and in what ways to show up, to tune in to what makes us come alive, what calls us forward? In her book, The Next Right Thing, Emily Freeman writes about what helps us to make decisions in our lives. She invites us to consider the role our soul and our heart play in those decisions. She invites us to reflect on the ways the divine shows up as well. And she invites us to ask ourselves one question when we're faced with a decision. Am I being led by love or pushed by fear? Am I being led by love or pushed by fear? In the process of considering what is the next right thing to do, in the process of deciding which way to go, in the process of discerning and searching and committing, am I being led by love or pushed by fear. Some have said that feeling the fear and doing it anyway is the definition of courage, but I would argue that it's deeper than that. It's listening deeply to what the fear is telling you and searching also for the love that is leading you. Maybe love is leading you somewhere scary. Maybe returning to public spaces is scary. Maybe visiting your friend who's sick is scary, or coming out to your family is scary. Maybe going to the recovery meeting is scary, or telling your friends and family that you're struggling. And maybe, if we look for it, at the center of all those things is love. And if love is leading you, then maybe that's okay. But if fear is pushing you, maybe it's time to pause and listen, or move and listen deeply for the voice of love, of community, of shared humanity. So I invite all of us into this space of living the questions, practicing how to love ourselves and each other. I invite us all to a place of finding that balance between who we are and what we need and who is traveling at our side. What do you wish for your fellow travelers? And do you wish the same for yourself? Are you being led by love or pushed by fear? To what are you committing your life? What makes you come alive? What helps you keep on moving forward into a life of authenticity, of purpose, of belonging? Will you choose love? Will you choose fear? May we all be led by love, and may we all have the courage to follow. So may it be. Amen. And blessed be. Let's sing together. Our next hymn will be number 6, Just As Long As I Have Breath. It's in your gray hymnal.
Let's join in saying the extinguishing chalice words that are printed in your order of service. As we extinguish the flame of this chalice, may we carry its light with us into the world in the power of peace, faith, justice, and love.
As we prepare to go back out into a world that asks so much of us, as we prepare to re-enter our communities with all of their beautiful opportunities and demands, let us breathe deeply. Let us take a moment to pause, to give thanks, to begin again in love. Let us be led by love and tune in to what calls us forward. As we go out into this beautiful and broken world, Let us bring with us our joy, our hope, and our promise of possibility. Go in peace.
I didn't hear from any college at ECC for my dad.